You're listening to The Critical Thought, where we challenge our listeners to use critical thinking when examining the teachings of Jehovah's Witnesses.
Remember this book that I read. In fact, we used to actually send this book out as gifts to people. The author, her name was Susan Forward. She wrote a book that was called Emotional Blackmail. And I'm gonna tell you, when you read the book, it really just sums up the life of a Jehovah's Witness. I mean, when I read it, I was like, oh my goodness, this is our life. We live the life of basically emotional blackmail. She described this concept, it's called living in the fog. And the fog stands for fear, obligation, and guilt. And that's really what it's like for Jehovah's Witnesses. Let me give you a perfect example. This is the best example I can think of. Fear. There are Jehovah's Witnesses, baptized, dedicated Jehovah's Witnesses, who are watching this video right now. And do you know what they're afraid of? Do you know what they're really afraid of? They're afraid of getting caught. Now, can you imagine that? We're talking about 35, 40, 50-year-old grown people, house note paying, rent paying, light bill paying, and yet they are afraid of getting caught watching this video. They pay for their own internet service, and yet they're afraid. Jehovah's Witnesses many times, they'll come to sites like this. Now, the watchtower there, and it's funny, because, and it's really funny because as former Jehovah's Witnesses, we know what the rules are. So when a Jehovah's Witness decides to click on his browser and come to a site where there are former Jehovah's Witnesses discussing the organization, you know, he's trying to play, he's dumb, like, I didn't know I wasn't supposed to be on that site. And it's like, it's funny, it's laughable. It's like, dude, you're not supposed to even be here if you really believe what you say you believe. Now, let me give you an example. You could have a brother. He's a brother who's reaching out, but he comes on websites like this at night. Now, the Friends of the Kingdom Hall, they don't know that, but he's afraid he's going to get caught. Because if he's being considered as a ministerial servant, the brothers, they see this outward appearance, him coming to the Kingdom Hall, him out in field service, and then secretly at night in the privacy of his home, where is he at surfing on the internet? Now, when you tell this to non-Jehovah's Witnesses, they can't believe it. I mean, I've told this to non-Jehovah, and they're like, you got to be kidding me. I said, yeah, that's right. Now, they'll say, like, so this is not a nudie site or, you know, a porno site? Nope. This is just a site where people are discussing different biblical topics, whether they agree with the Watchtower, whether they don't agree. That's all we're doing, basically. And he's like, they'll be like, and they can't even do that? Can't do that. And so these guys live in fear because if it came to the attention of his circuit overseer and the body of elders that this brother is surfing and talking and dialoguing with JT, if he was up for being a ministerial servant to hand out some pamphlets and hand out some books and count some time and do a little territory work, that's gone. They would snatch that from him. Now, what's interesting about this is that this is a type of fear that you always fear being caught. And so when you think about it, it's very unfortunate. This is one of their teachings, how to deal or how to interact or not interact with those who left the organization. That is the most basic teaching in the Jehovah's Witness faith. We don't interact with people who've left publicly. Publicly, but privately, in their homes, in the privacy of their homes, they have no problem. I mean, if you look at the comment sections in many of these forums, it's obvious, this guy's a Jehovah's Witness. What is he doing up here? But he lives in fear. This is the double life that a Jehovah's Witness has to live just to make it. Now, think about this. You have an individual, he wants to be a ministerial servant. He wants to be an elder. Now, when I first came on the internet years ago, there were actually elders, ministerial servants, pioneers, circuit overseers, district overseers, even Bethelites were in a lot of the different chat forums discussing. I used to tell people all the time, I said, y'all guys are getting an inside look at how the organization runs. I remember we had a dialogue going one time. It was between two elders who were in the organization, two elders who had left. And they were discussing a judicial case, how they're handled. And you could just tell by the people who were listening, they were chiming in back and forth, and they were just amazed. We didn't know that that happened. We didn't know y'all did that. And the dialogue just went back and forth. Well, when the society came out and dropped the hammer, I mean, they dropped the hammer. A lot of the elders disappeared. Ministerial servants disappeared. Pioneers disappeared. These guys were afraid. They stopped. I can't do this. They're going to take my stripes. And so it kind of left the internet with what you would call the weak ones in the congregation. And these are diehard people because they figure, I might not be doing nothing in the congregation, but I can go on the internet and I can represent the organization. And of course, at the end of the day, the organization don't want them representing them, not them anyway. And so witnesses, they live in this world of fear of always getting caught.
So isn't it interesting how that a Jehovah's Witness who comes on the internet to defend the society, he is going to represent the society. I'm gonna give the Jehovah's Witness viewpoint. And yet he is doing this out of complete fear that if he is caught, he's in trouble. So you have the Jehovah's Witness defender, then you have other Jehovah's Witnesses. You have Jehovah's Witnesses, and like myself, for example, you come onto the internet because you want to know. You want to know what is going on. Now, you know that you can't ask certain questions at the Kingdom Hall. Every Jehovah's Witness knows there's just some questions you can't ask. So a lot of witnesses, they'll go onto the internet. So if I can't ask the brothers at Kingdom Hall, I'll go onto the internet and see. And then they come onto these sites. They start reading. And then they start looking up certain articles. And they're like, well, that's true. They'll look up something else. Well, that's true, too. And then they'll see things that relate to what they personally know. And they're like, that's true. I don't care what nobody say. That's true. You know, it might not make us look good, but it's true. And so many times these persons, they too operate on the fear. I recall myself when I first ordered Ray Francis' book. We had a brother in our congregation who worked at the post office. And I was very concerned. I said, oh, he see the book come in. You know, he see the book come in. He see it's from Ray Franz, and it's going to be addressed to JT. Well, I'm going to be in trouble. And so as a witness, this is the type of environment that you constantly find yourself working under. Obligation and guilt. In Susan Forward's book, these were the other two components that make up the fog. The fear, obligation, and guilt. Obligation and guilt is very interesting how it takes place so many times in the congregation and in the lives of Jehovah's Witnesses. I mean, it's really amazing the way this takes place. Let me give you a few examples. Let's look at meetings, preparation for meetings. Preparation for meetings. Jehovah's Witness comes to the Kingdom Hall one day. There's no seats. He comes up, sits in the front right next to the Circuit OC and his wife. Circuit OC's wife looks over at his magazine. It's not on the line. What does this witness feel? Does this witness feel, man, I failed Jehovah? Nope. The witness is embarrassed. The witness feels guilty now. I didn't study my lesson. And the circuit overseer's wife sees it. Now, what happened to God? God didn't even come into the picture because this is the environment, the culture. As an elder, I would go on shepherding calls. And when you meet with the friends in their homes, especially people who have slowed down or stopped or whatever, you would find the same commonality. It was they had worn out. They just worn out. And it was as if they would say to you, they couldn't run fast enough, couldn't jump high enough. And the reason why is because the organization is a do more, do more, do more. You never will do enough. And as a result, it will simply just wear you out. And so what you end up with are people who fall under the obligation and guilt. The organization is very good at making Jehovah's Witnesses feel guilty. And they do it through their publications, through the circuit overseers, through the elders, through talks. And let me just give a couple examples. Take meeting attendance. What the society will do, they'll write these articles. These articles will be about somebody in Africa. Somebody who has, and the article will say, well, you know, they have to cross alligator-infested waters. And he gave the example of, like, the ones you often see where somebody had to cross alligator-infested waters. And so then, of course, the point we brought around, you know, living in the West, you know, we have cars, we can drive. And so basically, you know, if you can't make it to the meeting and this brother or sister over there in Africa, you know, they got to cross alligator infested waters. You know, why can't you come? And that's the basic message. OK. And so we're sitting there, you know, talking. He said, well, of course, you know, meantime, we don't tell everything about all the details because, you know, we're trying to make a point. And so we're like, well, what's some of the details? And he said, well, sometimes, for example, it may be they do have to cross alligator-infested waters, but everybody in town crosses the same alligator-infested waters. They've been crossing these alligator-infested waters all their life. Little kids, from the time they was old enough to walk, they had to cross alligator-infested waters. So it's not like they were really going out of their way. For them, it was really a part of life. In order to get to the other side, to get into town, this is how you had to do it. And so You grew up in an environment like that. It's not like you or I who have never crossed alligator-infested waters to go anywhere. But for a person who, well, you know, we learn all the tricks, we know how to do it, we know what to look for, but of course, that will kind of take away the punchline from the article. So they'll just tell you just the part about the alligator-infested waters, not all the details surrounding it. And so friends who couldn't make it to the meeting, they're feeling like, oh man, I didn't make it to the meeting tonight, and Sister Johnson over there in Africa, you know, she's swimming across the lake to get to the other side. And so these are little techniques that would be used that would just make people feel guilty. Another example that was often used for many, many years of how they could guilt trip their friends. A lot of elders used it, a lot of circuit overseers used it. Society, you know, that was one of their best articles probably for guilt tripping people, is the one that's known as the Sister with the Iron Lung. It was an article that the Society wrote about a Jehovah's Witness who she was confined to a chamber in her home so she could breathe. So she was very limited. She couldn't get out of the house and everything. She only could witness when the postman came by or someone stopped by. And so a lot of circuit overseers, a lot of elders, they would use this because they would say, look, she is confined to her house, and yet she has time to turn in every month. Look at you. You're not confined to your house, and you have no time or very little time. Or meeting attendance. You know, she is tied in to the Kingdom Hall by means of the phone line so she can get her meetings. And yet, if she could get out of that tube, she would be here. Yet, you can come to the Kingdom Hall and you're not here. And so over and over, you will get these types of articles. One of the best ones I've seen recently is the one with the summer conventions. The Society has told all the friends basically, look, after the convention is over with, we need for you to keep your suit and tie on. And when you go out to the restaurants and so forth, you need to have on your badge and you need to still be dressed, right? So you can imagine you have a family, they decide, or, you know, we're going to go change clothes and get casual. We've been sitting in the convention for the last 6-7 hours. We're going to go home and we're going to relax. And they go out to dinner. Across the table, they have a couple who in their suit and tie with their little badge on. And you can see the kids like, daddy, they still dress. Now, it's going to make them feel like what? They're going to feel guilty because they didn't keep on their suit and tie and their badge. And so it's this constant culture and lifestyle of Jehovah's Witnesses that puts them in the fog. Fear, obligation, and guilt. And many times these things have absolutely nothing to do with serving God. And that's what really, you know, critical thinkers is all about. You know, we want people to stop and think critically about a lot of the things that we as Jehovah's Witnesses were told to do or looked upon harshly if we failed to do these things. And that really drives home the point. So many things that as Jehovah's Witnesses that caused them to literally live in the fog was never something that God wanted people to do.